अरिहंतानम ओम नमो लोए सर्वत्रिकावर्ती सिद्धानम ओम नमो लोए सर्वत्रिकावर्ती आयर्याणम ओम नमो लोए सर्वत्रिकावर्ती ओज्जायानम ओम नमो लोए सर्वत्रिकावर्ती श्रावणम ओंकारं बिंदु संयुक्तं नित्यं ध्यायन्ति योगिनं कामदं मोक्षदं चैव ओंकाराय नमो नमः नमः समय साराय स्वानुभूत्या चकासते चित्स्वभावाय भावाय सर्वभावान्तरच्छिदे अज्ञानतिमिरन्धानां ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुर्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः तीर्थंकरो जगतनाजयवंत वर्तो ओंकारनाद जिननो जयवंत वर्तो जिनना समो शरण सौ जयवंत वर्तो ने तीर्थचार जगमा जयवंत वर्तो नमो ए तीर्थ नायक ने नमो ओंकार नाद ने ओंकार संगरते नमो ते श्री कुंद कुंदने अहो उपकार जिन वरनो कुंद नो ध्वनि दिव्य नो जिन कुंद ध्वनि आप्या अहो ते गुरु कानो अहो ते भगवती मातनो ध्रुव अचल ने अनुपम गति पामेल सर्वे सीदन वंदी कहो सुत केवल भाषित आसमय प्राभृत अरे ओम एक शुद्ध सदा अरूपी ज्ञान दर्शनमय कर कई अन्य ते मारू जरी परमाणु मात्र नथे अरे जमने प्रते मज ज्ञान नथी कारक नथी वेदक अरे जाने जकर मोदय निरजरा बंद ते मज मोक्ष ने ओम नमः सिद्धेव्य ओम नमः सिद्धेव्य ओम श्री शुद्धात्मा ने नमः Jai Jindra, everybody. Today is November 8, 2017, Wednesday, and we are continuing our discussion on Samasar. And we are coming to the point in which we'll be approaching 13th stanza. And as we said before, prior to 13th stanza, Amritchandra Acharya Dev, he wrote three Kalash. Kalash means the pinnacle. Just on the top of the temple, there is a pinnacle, and that's why it gives the importance of the temple. Same way here, Amritchandra Acharya Dev, he wrote down some of this stanza of his poem to supplement what Kunkun Acharya Dev wanted to convey to us. Remember, Kunkun Acharya Dev wrote down this original stanza close to 2000 years back, probably 50 AD. And Amritchandra Acharya Dev came sometimes 1000 AD. So they have about 1000 years of time difference between them too. But Amritchandra Acharya wrote down the commentary on the Samasar and all this extra stanza as if he entered Kunkun Acharya Dev's heart and tried to read what he was thinking. So that's why it's a great combination. And Gurudev Srikanthi Swami has expounded all this thing in great detail. So that's why we have a pretty good understanding of what Samasar is about and all the things. So, without further delay, I'll just come down to slides. Okay, so this is Samasar. We are coming to Samasar stanza 13, but then this is Kalash number 6. Last week we did Kalash 5, this is Kalash 6, and then there's Kalash 7. Three things are there. And those are the ones, they are kind of building up the excitement for the stanza 13 coming up. So 13 stanza is also important. As we said, 6 stanza is important, 11 stanza is important, 13 is important, 16, 17 is important, 38, and then 320. These are the main stanzas. And prior to coming to this stanza, Amrit Chandra Acharya wrote down these three stanzas. So we'll go through those things. So we'll sing this one first. Ekatve niyatasya suddha nayato vyapturyadastayanam purna gnana ganasya darsanamiha dravyantare vyaprathak samyak darsaname tadeva niyama datma chatavanayam tanmukva navatatva santati vini mamatma me kostuna. So this is that in a Sanskrit he wrote down this kalash, this stanza, and we will we'll dissect the each and every word, what's the meaning of those things. So tataha naha ayam eka atma astu, that word came. What does it mean? It means for the living being, the consciousness is the natural state of the soul. Soul, as we say in a Jainism Parashika class, basic Jainism, like Tuesday's class, what we say that soul, substances of the universe, they have a common attribute. So soul has a common attribute, and soul also has a specific attribute. So consciousness is a specific attribute by which it can be separated from all the six universal substances. So remaining five are one side, that they are non-conscious, and soul is only conscious element. So that way, it says that for living being, consciousness is natural state of our soul. But due to the wrong faith, for time infinite, I have a wrong faith. What's my wrong faith? I just say, body is mine, body is mine, body is mine. That kind of attention that I have it since time infinite. So living being is unable to recognize the true nature of the soul. I know whole world. I know who is this, who is that, who is that person, who is that building, who is the president of what country, and all. I know all the thing. But then I'm the knower. I forget about me. I'm the knower. So Kripalu Deva said in Atma Siddhi, Jananarte Jananai Kaye Keugna, means you don't know the all knower soul substance, and you try to know whole world, it is useless. That's what he said. So over here, that because of the I have wrong faith, that I am unable to recognize true nature of the soul, therefore I am an ignorant soul, because I have not known the real nature of myself. Therefore, it's been said here that one wishes to have wrong faith to go away so that he can experience real nature of the soul. So in the beginning of this stanza, there is an expression made that I would like to have, I wish my wrong faith go away, and I would like to have right faith. Then these other words, imam navatattva santatim muktva. What does it mean? In transmigratory state, soul has experienced nine elements in divisional aspect. This is deluding state. Remember, this is Acharya Bhagwan saying. And what he says, that in the transmigratory state, when I study extremely deeply about nine elements, soul, living, non-living, auspicious inclination, inauspicious inclination, inflow, bondage, shedding, shedding, and liberation. So these are the nine elements. And remember, I studied them in detail. I just found it out. Who are the living beings? How many divisions of living beings are there? One sense, two sense, three sense, four sense, five sense, five sense sentient being, and all kind of knowledge I gather. But they are the divisional aspect. I find it out, non-living being, like matter. Matter is made up of 27 different subgroups and everything, out of which carbon particles are more important. The gross body is more important. All those things, I understand that part. Medium of motion, what is it? Medium of rest, what is it? Then auspicious inclination, inauspicious inclination. All those things I study, but they are in the divisional aspect. And over here, it says that's a deluding state. Furthermore, it says, therefore, to experience nine elements in this way is a wrong faith. I mean, I go to the temple, I attend the classes, and all those things are being extremely minutely been explained to me. Like stoppage has 57 different subdivisions are there, and so and the shading has a 12 different divisions are there. All those things are wrong faith. Well, yes, not I'm not saying. Oh, Acharya Bhagwan is saying that one. He is saying that one. So what he says, if you just get stuck there only and do not progress, then it's a wrong faith. Why? Because over here we are coming to the 13th stanza. 13th stanza specifically says that out of these nine elements, nine reals, nine tattva, one goes and finds out the indivisibility of the soul substance, and that is the right faith. Simply knowing nine elements means nothing, is a wrong faith. It's a deluding state. So how does that happen? Well, yadasyatmanah iha dravyantarebhyah prathaka darshanam niyamat etadeva samyak darshanam. Okay, so what does it mean? So right faith is the attribute of the soul. Means faith is an attribute of the soul. We know by now, faith has two different modes. One is a wrong faith, or one could be right faith. Faith cannot be any third division, only two divisions. Wrong faith or right faith, mithyatva or samyatva. So, do I want to be in the wrong faith? No. Do I want to go to right faith? Yes. How do I go? So what it says, in transmigratory state, this attribute has altered modification. When I'm in transmigratory state, when I'm having the wrong faith, then this faith attribute, it has a wrong faith modification. When I realize my soul, then I have a right faith modification. So there's all or none between in this faith attribute. So that's why in Tattvat Sutra, Umaswati ji wrote down close to 2000 years back, the first chapter, first verse, it says, Samyak Darshan Gnan Charitrani Hi Mokshmargaha. So right faith, right knowledge, and right conduct, unity of those three things is a path to the liberation. Out of which right faith is the very first one that he is putting it on. Umaswati ji, Acharya Dev, he is putting right faith as the first one. So right faith has only two alternatives. Either you have, faith attribute has only two modifications, right faith or wrong faith. What do I want? Choices. My choice is very simple. I'm not given third choice. So everybody is lounging for going to the right faith. But what is that right faith? Because over here, in this one, it says that if I know the nine elements in divisional aspect, that's a wrong faith. Now, if I don't know the nine reals, nine elements, what's going to happen to me? I have to know them. Okay, you know it. But that's not end to it. That's what it means to say over here. The same attribute when having more in the pure form, then it's known as path to liberation state. Then it's called moksha marg. means that's on a fourth spiritual development state, and then person will progress from that self-experiencing phase further. He'll modify further. From fourth, he will progress all the way up to 13. That's called omniscient state. And from there, he'll go to 14, and then ultimately he'll become liberated soul. When this right faith mode is generated, then the new knowledge obscuring karma, etc., stop bonding with the soul. Why that thing happens? Well, for that thing, we already have gone through about the deluding karma karma chapter. How does deluding karma occur? And when the right faith is occurring, that means the infinite bonding, deluding karma gets stopped. So once you have right faith, remember two things only, wrong faith to right faith. Wrong faith, this is my body. I'm the owner of the body. I can do the function of the body. I can keep my diabetes under control. I can do the exercise. I can control my weight. I can do. You cannot do that. You are the soul. Your job is to only knowing. And physical body's job is separate. It's a matter particle. And soul cannot do the function of matter. Vice versa, matter cannot do the function of the soul. So, once I have this wrong faith that body is mine, instead of that, soul is me. I'm the soul. That kind of conviction occurs. And that kind of conviction leads me to the experiencing of the soul, and that's called right faith. And when that happens, majority of the karma bondage starts, they get stopped to get bonded. So right away, the load of karma coming to the soul stops coming. Remember, when we are in the wrong faith state right now, what is happening? Every moment, every samay, and remember, blink of an eye, innumerable time units pass by. And each time unit, we are binding, deluding karma. We are binding with those karma to us. Whether I'm sleeping, eating, quiet, or doing meditation, whatever I do, but still, my conviction that this is the body is mine, body is mine, body is mine, but that conviction, that means I'm binding the karma. For example, I don't have to know right now I'm Kirit. When I'm driving, I don't have to know it. When I'm eating, when I'm sleeping, I don't have to know it. But in the back of my mind, conviction is that I am Kirit. I'm Kirit. Somebody tells, hey Kirit, right away, I'll get up and I'll just say, yes, I'm here. So same way over here, once my body is mine, that kind of conviction I have it, that means each and every moment I'm binding the karma. And once that thing is gone, and now I'm the pure soul, I'm the eternal soul, and I get the experiencing of that, then I'm getting experience of that, then my karma bondage starts stopping. So karma stops coming. That means my load becomes less and less, and I remain greater and greater time I get engrossed within my soul. And that's ultimate thing, is to get engrossed within the soul. So old karma also start dissipating at the same time. New karma stops binding and old karma starts dissipating. Remember how many karma load I have it? Since time infinite, every moment I keep on binding karma, So tons and tons and tons of karma are there on my soul, loaded with that. Now, once I get the right faith, then karma bonding stops and old karma starts dissipating. So now I'm on the right track. Therefore, its path to liberation means moksha. Once I have the right faith more, wrong faith. Right faith more, I'm on the path to liberation. So this is a moksha. Samsara. That's a transmigratory state. Yeah. How is that pure? Now, if we are talking about right faith and looking at the pure soul and everything, so how is that pure soul? That means Suddha Nayataha Ekatve Niyatasya. What does it mean? Soul's attribute is consciousness. This soul's attribute is consciousness. As we say, this is a specific attribute for the soul, which is only seen in the soul and is not seen in the remaining five substances of the universe. Soul means every soul, whether it's the lowest form of life, nigodh, or the highest form of soul, which is a liberated soul. In between every soul, they have a consciousness. Think about it. Little ant. You put a fire here. And it just goes away because ant has a consciousness. You put a little sugar, it will get attracted because it has a consciousness. The matter particle will not do that. This phone has no capacity to know all the things. Yeah, there is so much memory and all those things, but there's a man-made thing. It's a matter particle. It cannot do the function that what I, me and you can do. So, soul's attribute is consciousness. Now, this consciousness is of three types, which is we are going to discuss further detail when it comes there. But we'll just give the names only: cognitive consciousness, and then consciousness of the experience of action, and third one is a consciousness of karmic consequences. So, jnana chetna, karma chetna and karma phal chetna. As I said, we'll discuss that as further when it comes. Now, this three subtypes of consciousness, what happens? First consciousness, cognitive consciousness, jnan chetna, is a pure one. And second and third chetna means a karma chetna, karma phal chetna, or consciousness experience of the action, or consciousness of karmic consequences, they are impure consciousness. Pure and impure consciousness. Now, impure consciousness is experienced since time infinite by wrong faith soul. If I have the wrong faith, since time infinite, I'm in the impure consciousness, means the second and third one only. Now, when the pure consciousness is experienced by right faith living being, so right faith living being has a pure consciousness or cognitive consciousness, and the wrong faith guys, they have the consciousness of experience of action, means a karma chetna, or consciousness of karmic consequences, means a karma phal chetna. So these are the consciousnesses. These we just gave some division or subdivision of it, and as I said, we'll discuss a little bit more when we are coming in the detailed section. Furthermore, how is this pure soul? Over here it says pure soul is with a consciousness. Furthermore, it's a purna jnana dhanasya. What does it mean? Purna jnana dhanasya vyaptu. What means this pure soul is with all attributes and modes. Pure soul, own attributes and mode. And it is with the right faith attribute of the soul is with division. Is right faith attribute of the soul is with divisions or indivisible? So it is indivisible with the soul substance. All the not only right faith attribute, but all the attributes, they are indivisible with the soul substance. The common example we are giving, that there is a bag full of rice, and each and every rice particle, they are separate, and if you take one out, nothing happens. If you take two out, nothing happens. But soul has infinite attribute. How many space points soul has it? Innumerable. Numerable innumerable and infinite. So soul is a space point, innumerable, asankhya, and the attributes are infinite. Now Gurudev Sri talks several times in these lectures on this stanza. He discovered the innumerability, the infinite attributes nature he described. He said souls are infinite in number. What is that infinite in number? Well, we'll just go through that thing. In the top of a needle, you take a teeny tiniest part of a vegetables grown underground, like potato. On the top of that needle, teeny tiny part of that potato, then they have the innumerable bodies are there. Each body has infinite amount of living being in that one body. Now you can imagine one body is an infinite living being, and there are innumerable body on the top of a needle. So you can imagine how many souls in top of that needle area. Furthermore, this cell having the infinite living being means past, present, and future. Past, present, and future liberated soul. Bhut, Bhavish, Vartmana, Siddha Bhagavanto. They are also infinite in number. They are liberated soul. And this cell has infinite times those liberated souls. Now you can imagine what's going to happen. You know, long back, maybe 15, 20 years back or something, I had a very crazy idea that, well, people, souls are getting liberated from the from this world. And so maybe one day there is nobody left and I'm only the one. So they say, okay, you come too, you know. But no, it never happened. Because this one cell alone has an infinite times infinite living being in that one cell alone. So you can imagine now how many infinite are. So this is only souls. Now, when we say infinite, there are several subdivisions of infinite. For example, if I give you two digits only, what is the permutation combination of two digits? It starts with 10 and it can end at 99. So 89 possible combination will give you two digits. If I three digits, then it will give me 899, I guess. And then four digits and five digits, or infinite. So infinite is infinite subdivisions. So souls are infinite in number. Matter, atomic particles are infinite times infinite. That's a second infinite. The three past, present, and future, the smallest unit of time, are the third infinite. And the space, which is a cosmic space and transcosmic space, that is a fourth infinite. And how many attributes I have within me is a fifth infinite. Now it gives you idea that I'm so loaded. I'm the richest of the rich person with that many amount of attributes within me. I'm complete. Purna Gnan Dhanasya. I'm complete. I have total number of attributes. That there is nothing more I need it. Lowest form of a living being also has that many attributes. The liberated soul also has that many attributes. And in between, we all have that many attributes. So, But they are remaining as indivisible in the soul substance, not like that bag of rice in which you can take one rice out, nothing happens. Two rice particles, nothing. This infinite attribute living in a innumerable space point, and they are indivisible in nature. So if you take one attribute out, everything will come out. So this is the nature of the attribute. So now furthermore it says atma chatavanayanam naha, means this soul substance is with right faith attribute. With this much amount of attribute within me also has a faith attribute within me, and I wish to have this type of soul be with me. That means I want to experience that soul which is me. So now we having said about the stanza, now we will start about the tika, means explanation of the stanza. So what happens? First thing I would like to remember, this stanza right now is leading us to 13th stanza. 13th stanza says that knowing nine elements, nine reals in divisional way is nothing. You have to understand there are nine reals, and in that nine reals, behind those nine reals, there is a pure soul is hiding, and that's where we have to go. So here, what is that nature of the pure soul? And why do I have to know and everything? So this one is, this stanza warms up for us to go to that stage. So I would like to obtain right faith in which there is experiencing of the eternal true nature of the self. I have studied nature of the elements in the divisional way since time infinite, which has no value right now because I did not go to indivisibility from divisional way. That has led to me to the wrong faith. By studying the nine elements in divisional way has given me wrong faith. I want to experience real nature of the soul with primary abstract comprehension, which is nirvikalpta. I would like to have nirvikalpta. And that's what my ultimate aim has to be. I want to go to Mount Everest, but for that I have to go to the base camp first. But base camp is not my aim. I just go to base camp and come back. Some of the people were saying that, oh yeah, you know, we are going to go to Mount Everest and we'll go up to base camp and come back. Why will you go there then? If your aim is to be Mount Everest, top of the mountain, why only base and come back? So I would like to have primary abstract comprehension nirvikalpa. In Moksha Prakasha, it says that nine real faith is a right faith. Now, this is Moksha Prakasha was written by Acharya Kalp Pandit Todarmalji about 250 years back. He had extreme sharpness of knowledge, and he was writing the material that some of the people did not like it. So they went to the king in Jaipur and they told the king that this guy's a phony baloney and all the things and everything. So now king decided that king was kind of he was ignorant guy, not knowing everything. So he decided that Todarmalji needs to be killed. Age 32. And Todarmalji is brought into the street, and the elephant comes, and the elephant is supposed to walk over him. Elephant comes and raises the foot, and then he stops there. He said, I cannot do that, I cannot do that. And Todarmalji says, you know what, elephant, don't worry about it. My life is coming to an end. You are simply an instrumental cause, you are not doing anything. Don't worry. So at age 32, he left this body. But till then, he wrote down so many radical things That's a Moksha Prakashak is a book. And actually that book actually is an introductory thing. But if you read that book, which is close to 350 pages long, nothing more than that. But it is so radicalized. And he gives nitty-gritty deep into the philosophy. And he says that nine real faith is a right faith. Now, previous slide we just said nine real faith is a wrong faith. So what is Todorovsky talking about here? Well, over there, nine reals are used singularly. Over here in this Moksha Prakasha, nine real word is used singularly. Means you understand nine real and then you keep them as singularly and find it out. There is a soul behind, pure soul hiding there. And that's why he said nine real faith is a right faith, but it's a singular word is there. It's not plural word. When experiencing of the soul in unified pattern, then one ends up knowing that there are no nine divisions of the eternal soul substance. Eternal soul substance is one unit with an infinite attribute in an indivisible form and everything. And so there are no nine divisions in the soul, no nine divisions in the understanding, because they are in one unit. And I'll sidetrack a little bit. What is nine reals that we are going to talk? And of course, it's going to come in 13 stanza. What is nine real? Nine reals are soul, means living, non-living, auspicious inclination, inauspicious inclination, inflow, bondage, stopping, shedding, and liberation. These are nine elements, but we will now define them. What does it mean? Living means the soul, any soul, from the lowest form of living being to the liberated soul, having the modification, soul having its mode, that is called living. Soul having the mode, that mode is called living. So all these nine the reals or nine elements, whatever name you would like to use, or nine tattva, they are modal forms. So when we say living, means soul with the modification, soul in its own modification. What is non-living? Non-living is not this phone, or not this computer, or not this physical body. Non-living is a soul's mode. Non-living is a soul's mode, knowing the alien objects. So, when we say living is my own mode, non-living is my mode which knows the alien objects of the universe. So that's called non-living. Auspicious inclination means I am having the auspicious inclination of doing donation or doing austerity or going to the temple, and all those things are good thoughts I have it. That is my mode, living being's mode. Inauspicious inclination, anger, deceit, ego, greed, influence of attachment, influence of aversion, those are my mode, soul's mode, living being's mode, living being's modification. Bondage is when the mode, which is auspicious or inauspicious inclination, and then it is the intensity of those auspicious, inauspicious inclination that is called bondage. Stoppage means the beginning of purity in the soul. Shedding means increase in the purity of the soul. And liberation means complete purity of the soul. So all these nine elements are only residing within me in the form of mode. When we say non-living, doesn't mean it's a non-living some other substance. It's my mode, my mode, my mode. So that's a nine reals. Now, when one experiences nine real in the divisional form, then it's a wrong faith. When I experience them in the indivisible form, then it is called right faith. So to know the soul, two ways we can do, and this is the important philosophical basis for the Jain principles. It always gives anything from positive affirmation and negative affirmation, asti and nasti. Positive affirmation: to experience soul in primary abstract comprehensive state, nirvikalp dashama atmani anubhuti. Experience a soul in primary abstract comprehensive state. That's a positive affirmation. And negative affirmation: the soul is separate from the alien belonging. Remember, only we take one thing, only negative affirmation: the soul is separate from alien belonging. So I'm not this, 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 I know other things, but then who am I? I don't know that part. Or other way around. Okay, I'm the pure soul, I'm the pure soul, and I'm just remaining engrossed into the alien belongings. Then also it's not right. To know the soul, positive affirmation, primary abstract comprehension, negative affirmation, soul is separate from alien. Both the things have to be known. And that's the right way to do it. Now, soul is separate from alien belongings like auspicious, inauspicious inclination, anger, deceit, ego, greed. In fact, soul is separate from omniscient Lord, Holy Scripture, and enlightened teachers. And last one is, his soul is separate from nine reals in the divisional form. So soul is separate from those things. First, one ends up making such decision on his reflective thought. Now, I am making this decision in my reflective thought, my vikalp jnana. That, okay, I'm not this, I'm not this, I'm not this, I'm not this, I'm this, I'm this, this is my nature, all those things, their reflective thoughts are there. Soul having self-illuminating property means prakash shakti. Remember, as we said last week also, in the samaisar, most of the time, all the way up to 415 stanza, Acharya Dev keeps on saying, Kunkuna Acharya Dev keeps on saying, Amritchandra Acharya Dev keeps on saying, knowledge is a soul, soul is a knowledge, all knower soul substance, knowing, 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 knowledge, attribute. And knowledge, knowledge, knowledge gives so much importance that at the end of 415 stanza writing commentary on it, Amritchandra Acharya Dev thought that, wait a second, he had the reflective thought came to him. He just said, by doing this one, the reader will have a wrong idea that there's only one attribute in the soul called knowledge attribute. And we already said before that infinite attributes are there. So he also wrote the appendix on it, and he said the 47 powers are there, the infinite powers are there, but known are 47. Experienceable 47 power, and one of them is prakash shakti, means self illumination property. So what does it say? Because of the property due to which living being experiences and knows the eternal true nature of the self directly through his sensory and scriptural knowledge, I end up experiencing my soul directly with my scriptural knowledge and sensory knowledge. So that is a function of the prakash shakti. This state is absolute form of right faith. When I experience that's an absolute form of right faith. When I know from the scripture and everything, listening to the learned saints and reading the scripture and everything, that's called indirect way of knowing the soul's nature. But now I have experience. Let's say that somebody has never seen this form, and I describe so much about it, it means nothing to them. But when that phone is in his or her hand and start pressing the different buttons and everything, then he will understand what that thing is. Until then, everything was indirect knowledge. Once he has experienced himself, that's experienceable knowledge, experiencing knowledge, and that's called right faith. For knowing this one only, but me, I'm the soul substance, so I know about it in the reflective thought, and then I get primary abstract comprehensive state, which is real nature of my soul. Now, there is something Gurudev Sri touched very quietly, very intelligently to say that there are seven predications are there. Sapta Bhangi is there. And first predication is substance exists due to self and not due to alien objects. A little bit more about seven predications. Seven predications means Syadvad means dialectic relativism. Dialectic relativism means Syadvad. Syad means for certain perspective, Vad means to speak. To speak a sentence from certain perspective, that is called Syadvad. And that one can be seen only in a seven different ways. So first one, it says, so substance exists due to self and not due to alien object. So now, what are those seven predications? Well, seven predications are first. From certain perspective, we are talking example of a pot. Certain perspective, pot is there. It's called Syat Asti. Asti means presence, Syat means certain perspective. From certain perspective, pot is not there. Remember, there is a pot over here, and there's also some other, there's a glass over here. So when I'm looking at the glass, glass is not pot. So from glass's perspective, pot is not there. That's a syat nasti. Nasti means not to be there. Syat means from certain perspective. Now, third, from certain perspective, pot is there and pot is not there. Means presence of pot on the table is there, but when I'm looking at the glass, then from glass perspective, pot is not there. So there's a third predication. Fourth one, for certain perspective, pot is inexpressible. Why it's inexpressible? Remember, over here, we are saying that a certain perspective, pot is there and pot is not there. When I'm talking about it, pot is there and pot is not there. I needed two sentences. Means one sentence, let's say it's lasting for one second. Second sentence lasts for second. So I need 2 seconds minimum to express that the pot is there and pot is not there. Pot is there from the pot perspective. In the glass, pot is not there from glass perspective. But when I'm talking in a sequence over in number three, I'm talking in sequence. Number four, both the things are together. Pot is there from pot perspective, pot is not there from the glass perspective. Both is occurring at the same moment. And I cannot express in the word. Only way I can express is from the sequences over here. But non-sequential thing which is present, I cannot express in non-sequential way. It appears to be a little Greek and Latin right now, but if you think about it, it's a deep meaning is there. I'll come back after seven things are done. I'll explain to them. From certain perspective, pot is there and also not expressible. Now, I can say pot is there, but when I'm talking about pot is there, at the same time, pot is not there in the glass perspective, I cannot express that one. Together, simultaneously. So that's a fifth predicament. That with last one, next one. So certain perspective, pot is not there from glass perspective, and also not expressible. But from glass perspective, pot is not there, but at the same time, pot is here, which I cannot express simultaneously. I need to express in a sequential way, but simultaneously I cannot express. And last thing, from certain perspective, pot is there, and pot is not there, and pot is not expressible. Pot is here, pot is not here in the glass, and everything cannot be expressed in a simultaneous way. So that's a number seven predication. Now, when Acharya Bhagwan, when Tirthankar Bhagwan is giving his discourses, Tirthankar Bhagwan is sitting in Samosaran, and he is giving his discourses. He doesn't speak just like us. He is not speaking from the mouth also. From the whole body, Omkar sound comes out. And Om sound is a composite sound. Om sound expresses everything. Over here, we are looking at the limitation of the language that something cannot be talked simultaneously. But Om sound, one sound of Om alone, has expression of 12 canons, Bar Angni Rachna. 12 canons, they have been created by first disciple of the Lord by hearing the word sound of the sound named Om. Om sound, when somebody, Gandhar Bhagwan, the first disciple of our Lord, when they hear that sound, they once, because they are also eligible personalities, so by hearing that sound in a composite form, in a simultaneous way, one sound came and it includes everything that one has to know in the spirituality with the 12 canons Bar Ang. Yesterday, Kathy was there in the class and we were talking about it. The 12 canons, the first canon is called Acharang Sutra. And Acharang Sutra has 18,000 chapters, and each chapter has 510 million plus stanzas are there. So now you can imagine, first Acharang Sutra has how many stanzas are there? So by knowing that way, this is the first one. Second one is 36,000 chapters, and each chapter is 510 million plus stanzas are there. You know what? I know Atma Siddhi by heart, 142 stanza. I know Samaisar, 415 stanza. And I'm taking pride in myself. And I said, wow, I'm the greatest of the great. But what about those knowledgeable people, like a first disciple of Bhagwan, that they can have one sound falling on their ear and they can create the 12 Ang, which is a huge number of scriptures. So that's why Om sound is a composite sound, and we as a transmigratory soul, we have the seven predications because our language has a limitation. We cannot express everything. Some of the things, for example, I felt good within. How can I express that one? Tell me. In words, I cannot express. So those are the things that Om sound comes out, Gandhar Bhagwan creates the 12 canons out of it. So that's why that's the 7. Now over here we took the example of pot to make it easy to understand. Now life cannot be that easy, right? So we have to make it complicated. So now Amrita Acharya Dev in Panchastika commentary, he is given the all 7 predications in this way. Number one, substance is said to have existence due to its own self innate quality. Substance is said to have existence due to its own self innate quality. Means Dravya Kshetra Kal Bhav means innate quality of substance, area, modes, and quality. So substance exists because of this, its own things. Because substance is its own substance, it has its own area, it has its own modes, it has its own quality or the attributes. So substance exists because of its own. Now, second predication. Substance is said not to have existence due to self innate quality of alien substance. Par chatushtay. This was swachatushtay. This is par chatushtay. Par chatushtay means alien quartet of a substance, area, modes, and quality. This substance has its own quartet. This soul has its own quartet. So this soul does not have quartet of this form. This is its own. So this is from the second predication. Third one. Substance can be expressed in sequence from its innate as well as alien quartet, swa and parchatushtay. Means, I am the soul. I live within my own limitations of a substance, area, modes, quality, and I am the one which does not have properties of the alien object. So this can be expressed in sequence. Even though both the things are together, it is expressed in sequence. Okay. Now, substance is inexpressible from consideration of the simultaneous presentation of self as well as alien quality. So simultaneously over here, third one says it can be expressed only in sequence. Simultaneously, it cannot be expressed because we have a limitation of our language. Then continues on next slide. Substance cannot be expressed simultaneously from following two aspects, its own innate quartet as well as from perspective of the self and alien quartet together. So again, this is permutation combination of those words we are using. So fifth one and sixth one is same way. Substance cannot be expressed simultaneously from following two aspects, alien quartet as well as from perspective of the self and alien. Over here, innate quartet as well as both the quartet together. Over here, alien quartet and both the quartet together cannot be expressed simultaneously.
I walked in late, but wow. So this is, you're doing the 7 nays on this?
No, Saptabhangi. Saptabhangi.
Okay, so can you go back one slide, please?
Okay, all right.
Number 2, okay. I'm trying to understand that. It says a substance is said not to have existence due to the self innate quartet
of alien object. This one is its own self quartet, right?
Yeah.
And I have my own self quartet. So I do not exist because of this quartet of this form. Bones,
you do?
Kshetra Kal Bhav is separate than mine. I don't exist because of our phones, Dravya Kshetra Kal Bhav.
So is that to say then, from the point of view of Par Chatushtay Sat, you don't have Sat? You don't have existence?
Yeah, because Par is Par, right? Alien object is alien object. And I don't exist because of alien object. My existence does not depend on the alien objects. That's what in short it says. And
well,
then, yeah, go ahead.
What you say now makes sense, that it doesn't depend on Par, but yes. do I exist? For example, from your Chatushtay point of view, do I exist? Me, Chirag, from your Dravya Chatushtay point of view, do I exist?
No. For example, I have one car and my brother has the exact same car. The same car, but they are two different things, right? This car and this car are separate. This car cannot do the function of this one, and this one cannot do the function of this car. This car wants to start, it needs its own key and everything. This car wants to start, it needs its own key and everything. Same way, you as a soul and I as a soul, we both are soul, but we have different self quartet. Your substance, area, mode, and attribute.
I agree that, Kirnagla, I agree it's different, it's separate, yeah. But I have a problem when we say that from one Atma's point of view, another Atma does not exist. Is that what we're saying?
Because actually, to the extent Acharya Bhagavan says, from me as a soul, you are non-living. Because you cannot enter...
But non-living is fine, but Haji, exist... To not exist is different from non-living. Satnati. Koi vastu. But dravya ni chatushtay ni bahar jao, to there is no sat. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that's what it is. Only because each substance has its own limited work sphere. Beyond my work sphere, I cannot influence anybody. Beyond your work sphere, you cannot influence me. So for me and you, we are separate. So for me, you are non-existent. From my perspective, you are existing from your perspective.
That's a strong statement. And then on the next slide, if you go number 5 and 6, I'm trying to understand, aren't they just contradicting each other?
No.
What are they saying here?
Okay, all right. It, because, you know, if you have that question, I had lots of questions a few years back. It took a long time to understand. What it says, word over here, is this word is important. Expressed. Where is my word? Word is expressed, okay? Now, over here is a word is express, okay? So that one is common. Now, when I as a soul, word, another word is simultaneous. Over here, simultaneous. Simultaneously, at one sentence, one summary, I cannot express two aspects. What are those two aspects? Here. Number first aspect is my own innate quartet, and perspective of self and alien quartet together, because alien quartet and self quartet are also there, because, you know, this is there, I am there, both are there, but they both together as one unit, and my own innate quartet, I cannot express simultaneously together. For example, I'm making two or three sentences. I am my own self. Number one. Second thing, I am myself, and this is separate, that cannot be expressed simultaneously. Over here, this point. Substance can be expressed in sequence. About from its innate quartet as well as alien quartet. I'm existing because of my innate quartet. I'm not existing because of an alien quartet. Remember over here, it just get substance does not exist due to alien quartet. Substance exists because of its own quartet. So I'm existing because of my own. I don't exist because of the alien quartet. Now, over here, what it says, that thing, the two things over here together, I exist because of myself, I don't exist because of other things, that together, and at the same time, he found to say, I exist because of myself. So those three things cannot be explained in one sentence. That's what he's trying to tell us. Expression simultaneously. You can just sequentially, you can express anything you like it, but simultaneously it cannot be expressed.
So okay, that makes sense, because in both cases it's saying you cannot express.
You cannot express it.
See, and the word expressed, in Shastra, what word do they use for that?
Word express.
Vyakta?
Vyakta, vyaktata. Vyakta and simultaneous together. Simultaneous means ek sathya. Ek sathya, vyakta not.
When we talk about Swaprakashak and we talk about Laksh. So there we have something similar. You can have Laksh on your Atma or you can have Laksh on Par. You can't have them simultaneously. So expression here, Vyaktata, Laksh, are those the same thing?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Is that all the same idea?
Yep.
Okay.
But only thing that, see, that's why the basis that I'm coming, because I just said about the Tirthankar Bhagwan's Vani, Tirthankar Bhagwan's lecture, it is not in our language form, but it is in the form of Om, which is a complete, it's a simultaneous expression of whole reality. Remember, over here we are talking one or two things only, but in Bhagwan's Om Dvani, six substances, past, present, future, all these substances, their attribute and their mode, in the Om sound, everything comes out. One thing only, and simultaneously, all those zillions and zillions and zillions of things, infinite things, are being expressed in that thing. So it just says, our languages have limitation. So that's why sometimes it can give a wrong message. Wrong message. For example, the previous slide, a few slides back, it said that to know the nine real from a divisional aspect is a wrong faith. You mean I should not know nine real in divisional aspect? You have to start that way. What is a living? What is divisions of the living? One sense, two sense, three sense, four sense, five sense non-sentient, five sense sentient, and each one is fully developed or partially developed. So there are 14 different types are there. Non-living means matter, medium motion, medium grace, space and time. Then auspicious activities. In auspicious activity, we can do it 108 different ways. Then comes the inflow. There are five different ways you can have inflow. So stoppage, you can have 57 different. So all those things you know, but ultimately, you have to put everything together in the indivisible pattern to understand that out of these nine reals, there is a behind, there is an eternal soul, pure eternal soul substance is hiding, and that's where I have to go. So that is a 13th stanza. That's where we are coming to. So this way, Amritchandra Acharya Dev takes us in that direction slowly but surely. So this one was its own innate quartet. This is alien quartet. Basically, otherwise it's the same thing. And this one is everything cannot be expressed simultaneously. So these are the seven predications are there, and out of which each time when Gurudev gives lecture, he just throws some of these things and he just speaks and walks away. But it is our duty to understand. First time he said in this one over here, he said, very good. He said, substance exists due to self and not due to alien object. And that's one of the seven predications. That's all he said. But now, one of the seven predications, what are those things? It is our duty to understand. So, now, soul has multiple infinite power, 47 described in the Samaisar appendix. Seventh one is a supreme sovereignty power, which is called Prabhutva Shakti. What is a Prabhutva Shakti here? Prabhutva Shakti means, due to this power, soul is independent and does not depend on alien objects of the universe. This is the power I have it within me. This is the power every soul has within them. And because of this power, that I do not depend on alien objects, I'm independent. And that's what Gurudev Sri kept on saying for 45 years, that the independence of the soul as a substance, independence of every universal substances, independence of all the attributes within, the infinite attribute within me, knowledge attribute does its own function, and faith attribute does its own function, conduct attribute does its own function. They all do their own job. They don't interfere anybody else's work. And then there is also independence of the modes. Modes are independent. For example, how do I understand that? Well, I live in United States of America, and I follow the rules and regulations of the government. Now, as long as I pay the taxes and as long as I follow the rules and regulations, then within my own home, I can do anything. Food pyramid says you have to eat so much fish, you have to eat so much egg, you have to eat so much meat and everything. I'm not going to do that. So I'm independent. Same thing, mode is occurring in the soul, but mode has its own mind. Mode decides that, okay, I want to be in the rag mode. I want to be in the interest of attachment state. Mode does its own. Soul, substance cannot interfere in that one. So that's why independence of the soul as a substance, attribute, and also the modes. Not only the modes, but origination of the mode, cessation of the mode, constancy of the mode, those are also independent. Origination does not depend on cessation. Cessation does not depend on origin. Means they have gone to such a microscopic level to prove that everything is independent. And that is because of this Prabhutva Shakti that I have it within me. Supreme sovereignty power that I have it within me. No other philosophy can take this kind of sentence and say, yes, we are independent. Pick up any philosophy. They all have dependency on quote-unquote Almighty God. Oh my God, what will happen if God will do this, God will do that? No, God cannot do anything to me. I'm independent in my own action. If I do bad, I do bad. If I do good, I do good. If I go within myself, I go within myself. I have independence. Soul is an individual form and with serenity. Means it's aware and nirvikalpa. This is spelling type over here. Sorry for that. So due to this power, modes are also independent. We already talked about it. And from comprehensive knowledge point of view, now Acharya Bhagwan takes us a little bit deeper and says, I'm going to tell you about comprehensive knowledge, and I'm going to tell you about the partial point of view. What is comprehensive knowledge? Comprehensive knowledge means total knowledge of everything. And I don't want to know every substance is total knowledge. I want to know what about me as a soul. So I am a soul substance. I have an infinite attribute. I have infinite modes within me. Each mode has origination, cessation, constancy. All those things to know together, that this is the soul has this kind of structure within. That is called comprehensive knowledge. So with the comprehensive means pramandnan. Pramandnan, so soul is with its infinite attributes and modes. These modes could be pure or impure form, but they belong to soul. Remember, within the soul's sphere of action, pure modes are occurring and impure modes are occurring. My mode of influence of attachment, my mode of anger, deceit, ego, greed occurs within me. It's not that somebody sitting next to me making me angry. It's not that somebody pulling my leg and that's why I'm falling down. So that's nothing like that. So let's say that tomorrow's stock market crashes, whom you are going to blame? No, you cannot blame to everybody. So modes occurring into me, pure or impure, it is within me. It is from the comprehensive knowledge point of view. Now, this comprehensive knowledge makes soul separate from alien objects of the universe, including you. You as a Chirag is separate from me because my comprehensive knowledge is only limited to me. Your comprehensive knowledge is limited to you. So it makes all alien objects of the universe separate. This comprehensive knowledge of this phone is separate and comprehensive knowledge of mine is separate. For example, I want to go to the market and I want to buy the fruits. So all kind of fruits are there. That's kind of quote unquote comprehensive knowledge. Out of which I need only banana, so I separate banana from everybody else. So all these things are present and then I find it out characteristics of banana. And so I separate banana from other fruit and I buy the banana that way. Now, the same soul perceived from your point of view, now or up to here, that I have separated myself from the alien objects of the universe. How did I separate? Because I have my comprehensive knowledge, everybody else has, you have your comprehensive knowledge, and so I am separate from everybody. So I separated from everybody else, just like the way I separated banana from all the rest of the fruits in the supermarket. Now, when I bring the banana at home, what happens? The same soul perceives from pure point of view, then all modes and attributes become secondary and only eternal soul substance becomes a primary one. So what happens here? For example, the banana, I brought it home, but this the skin has no importance for me. Only the white part is important for me to eat. So this is what I want. Same way in the soul substance, when I separated from rest of the six universal substances of the universe, I separated soul, just like I separated banana from rest of the fruits. Now, when I come to the soul over here, then I say, what is most important? Eternal, true nature of soul, permanent, immutable, inseparable, unique form of soul, that is me. So this is very important way to understand. And this is the right faith. For example, I want to do the stealing. So I just scanned the whole street out. And out of the whole street, I said, this is the house that is better for me to do stealing because there is only one or two people living and whatever. So I decided that. So I separated that house from rest of the houses. So that's a first form of separation from alien other houses. Now, I studied that house extremely deeply and then find it out what is happening in the house, what's the layout of the house, where is the bathroom, where is the kitchen, where is the bedroom, where is the TV room, all those things. And then I find out exactly where is the hidden gem area. There is an underground vault in that area in one of the closet. So now I concentrate on that closet and I find it out that I have to go to that place. How will I go there? So now when I'm actually going for stealing, I enter the house and I make everything secondary. Means kitchen, I don't worry about it. Bedroom, I don't worry about it. Bathroom, I'm not worried about it. Piano area. Only the thing, I go to that area where there is the vault is there and I take the vault and that is my thinking. So ultimately, over here, separated banana from rest of the thing. I brought banana home, take the skin also out, and this is what important for me. Same way, eternal soul substance is important for me, and that's the right way. Having said that, let's see now. Two existences are proven in this slide. What are the two existences? For soul is having its own existence separate from the alien object of universe and is having its own attribute of pure and impure modes. That's a comprehension knowledge perspective. So I separated soul from rest of the alien objects. Matter, medium of motion, medium of rest, space and time, I separate them out. So that's a comprehension knowledge. But soul is eternal and indivisible and does not have any divisions of attribute and mode within. Means divisions, attributes and modes are there, but divisions are made secondary. An eternal soul substance is made primary. And this is from pure point of view. This is from comprehensive point of view. This is from the pure point of view. So we have to understand first comprehensive point of view. Then we have to know what's a pure point of view. So here we will stop over here. If there's any question, we can entertain. Basically, Amritchandra Acharya Dev is doing one job over here, preparing for us that pure point of view is important. Pure point of view is important. Only eternal, pure soul substance is important. And he is making the steps for us to go to the 13th stanza. When the 13th stanza comes, it is really beautifully done by Kunkun Acharya Dev, telling us that what is this about nine reals made up of? How is those rag, vesh, mode, or the asral, samvar, nijra, bandh, moksh modes are coming? How are they originating and all the thing? It's a brilliantly it's been explained, and when we know it, it will be we'll be very happy that okay. So all this thing we know it because we have done our homework until 12th stanza. Any questions? Okay. If not, then we'll do the closing. Okay. जावानी के ज्ञान से सूझे लो कालो सोवानी मस्तक नमो सजा दे नमो यंता नमो सिद्धा नमो अरिण नमो सम नमो लोय सोषा नमो यंता नमो सिद्धा नमो अरिण नमो सम नमो लोय सोषा नमो यंता नमो सिद्धा नमो अरिण नमो सम नमो लोय सोषा Namo Orientana, Namo Siddhana, Namo Aryana, Namo Jana, Namo Loya Sausana. Namo Orientana, Namo Siddhana, Namo Aryana, Namo Jana, Namo Loya Sausana. Namo Orientana, Namo Siddhana, Namo Aryana, Namo Jana, Namo Loya Sausana. Namo Orientana, Namo Siddhana, Namo Aryana, Namo Jana, Namo Loya Sausana. Namo Orientana, Namo Siddhana, Namo Aryana, Namo Jana, Namo Loya Sausana. Namo Orientam, Namo Siddhanam, Namo Aryanam, Namo Jnanam, Namo Loye Sarvasam. Jai Janendra. Mitshayindukra. Thank you.
Mitshayindukra.
Thanks, Ben.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kathy.
Thank you.